Good morning. I am Keith Rasmussen, the Associate Director of Music for Traditional Music and Organist at the United Methodist Church of Sun City Center. We are preparing for another organ recital. We have some really exciting music for you, some wonderful sounds, and some interesting things, I think, for today. We'll be talking about why or how I choose some of the registrations for these pieces, and a bit about the organ, and we're doing a hymn arrangement again, and helping you understand the organ, the most expensive instrument and the least understood for most people. I'd also like to mention that our services are on Sunday morning, 9:45 for contemporary and 11 o'clock for traditional. You'll always hear fine music. You'll always hear superlative preaching. And it's a really good service to attend either online or in person when we open up again. Our first piece today is the Rigaudon by Campra. Campra was a Baroque composer, contemporary roughly with that of Johann Sebastian Bach and Handel. And he did church music until he was established well enough with music of the theater. And then when he could make enough money in the theater, then he left the church music off and did just the theater. Some of us go the other direction, talk about that in a week or two. But this Rigaudon has three really crucial chords at the beginning and at the beginning of each refrain, as it were. This uses the full choruses of the organ, and particularly contrasting the reed stops or the trumpet stops. So the Rigaudon by Campra.
Thank you.
That piece is so much fun to play, and those three chords are so powerful, and then the organ builds at the end to very brilliant and very deep. That low, low rumbling sound that you hear is a low pedal trumpet or a reed stop, which defines the bottom pitch of the organ. And then the high pitches or the mixture stops define the top pitches of the organ. And then the other stuff is the bologna and the sandwich. And you have to kind of consider all of that when you're registering things and how it's going to affect people in the room, how it's going to affect the music and things like that. I'd like to take this moment to introduce my son. Gabriel, would you come out here for a second, please? Gabriel is my 9-year-old son. He sits with me here while I'm taping, and he often, when I'm practicing, he'll sing my pieces back to me. He's a great singer and a wonderful little boy. So he's my buddy, and he's here with me this morning. Thank you, Gabriel. You can go back to your place. That was the Rigaudon by Comper. You can go back to your place now, big boy. I love you. The next piece is the poem Mystique by Purvis. This is our quasi-hymn arrangement for today. It's composed on a hymn that's only in the Christian Science hymnal, which I don't have access to, but you'll probably recognize the tune when it comes in the left hand in the clarinet. It starts very mystically with chimes, and then the clarinet brings in the melody, and then it ends again quietly. And you may not hear it so well in this taping, but the last chord is in the antiphonal organ, the speakers way in the back of the church with quiet chimes. So it's kind of like it's going farther and farther and farther away, and then it just stops. So the poem Mystique by Richard Purvis. I learned this when I was in high school. I never played it very well. I spent some time on it the last couple of weeks and found ways of making it work better and found the colors that I was looking for on this organ. Basically, I'm using the quiet strings. For those of you who are organists, I'm using the unison flat strings, which makes a little bit darker color. And being I'm playing up higher, it makes it even more mystical. So the poem, Mystique, by Richard Purvis, who was the organist at Grace Cathedral in San Francisco for 25 years.
Thank you.
Each week I will talk a little bit about how to play an organ of this size. You notice you never see me reaching out and grabbing for stops. This organ is too large and too complicated for that, so I always set everything on the general pistons. But you notice you never see me pushing those general pistons, do you? Or very rarely. That's because there's a little button down beside the swell pedals down there that says next. So I set my generals up one after the other after the other. I just push the next button with my toe, which usually is free, and then that goes on to the next general, and I set them linearly and consecutively, so it's easy to do that way under pressure. I should also mention, I appreciate all the people who spent time to email me last week. We had over 300 people who visited the concert, which is far more than we've ever had for a recital here. That's really encouraging. There's a lot of things to come here soon. We have some new TV cameras on site that are being prepared as we speak, and there will be a TV camera right over there above the choir, which will be able to zoom in on the organ, on the piano. You'll be able to see my hands and feet better. There's two other cameras in the church as well, so there'll be a lot more angles and a lot more options. So stay tuned. Things are going to become more and more and more interesting. Did I say more interesting? Yes. This is a wonderful time to be at this church and be a part of the ministry here. The next piece is a piece by Pietro Yon, Y-O-N. He was the organist at St. Peter's in Rome for a while. He came over to New York City, and I think it was the late 20s or early 30s, and was the organist of a large Roman Catholic cathedral there. He composed quite a bit, played quite a bit, and this humoresque by Pietro Yon was designed for a little Baroque or ornamental organ that he saw in a museum, which had one set of pipes, flute pipes. And this little humoresque is something that you could play on one set of flute pipes. I heard this for the first time in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada, when I lived there. And Diane Bish was giving a concert on a large Cassavant pipe organ there. And she played this piece for the encore. And I thought, that's really interesting. So while she was greeting her guests, I walked up to the organ, found what the piece was, ordered it, and learned it. I've listened to lots of people play this, and I've arrived at what I think is the best performance. I listen to YouTube a great deal, to different organists, to different instruments, to different repertoire, and kind of figure out what I would like to do and what I don't want to do. This tempo, I think, helps the piece just kind of play itself. It's just kind of a neat little piece on just the flute stops. Now, I'll tell you a little secret. Two of these flute stops are pipe, and two are digital. If you can email me and tell me which is which, you'll be very, very clever. I'll appreciate your feedback. Anyway, the humoresque for the flute stops by Pietro Yon. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed that, listening to that as much as I enjoyed playing it. It just kind of ripples along, and it's just a lot of fun. I would just mention one of my specialties is teaching pianists who have been dragged kicking and screaming from the piano bench to the organ bench when an organist is needed, showing them how to play the organ. It isn't all that difficult, and once you get the stops set up, it's not really hard at all. One of the things I teach them is that on the piano, when you play a note louder, it gets an accent. If you push a note harder on the organ, it doesn't make any difference because the pipe is either on or off. So what you do is you hold the note longer for an accent and shorter or almost quasi-staccato to make it less noticeable. So in the right hand, on that piece, I was emphasizing the first note a little bit longer and the other notes just a little bit shorter. And that way you hopefully can hear the top note highlighted above the rest of the flute stops. Did anybody figure out which is pipe and which is digital? I'm looking forward to finding out from your emails. The last piece we're going to play today is the trumpet tune by Clark. Now, people have asked me, is a trumpet tune, is a trumpet voluntary? I don't know, and I'm really not too sure I care, because different books and different editions will have different names. I call them Trumpet Tune 1, Trumpet Tune 2, Trumpet Tune 3. Trumpet Tune 1 was the one I played last week, the Purcell, dum, 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 da, dum, da, dum. This one is the Clark, which is dum, dum, da, da, dum, da, dum, dum, dum. And at the very end, our biggest trumpet stop, the Anshamad, is going to soar over the whole organ with the last entrance of the trumpet tune. So a trumpet tune by Clark, for me, it's number 2. I've played this so many times for different weddings and used to cutting it and pasting it. Now I can just make it so it all balances together and not have to worry about a bride coming down the aisle. So enjoy the trumpet tune. thank you for coming and listening today. That piece is so much fun to play. You can only imagine how thrilling it is to come down on those big chords at the end. And I would mention, if anybody is in the area of Sun City Center, would like to come by and see the organ, come by and I'll be glad to show it to you. It's a Rogers Infinity 484 with 8 ranks of pipes. So we have well over 600 digital and pipe sounds available. And as you can hear, it's really pretty impressive. Next week, we're hearing works by Gabriel Pierre, who was a successor of César Franck. We're hearing Jesu Joy of Man's Desiring by Bach, and the Cortege and Litany by Marcel Dupré. We'll be talking a little bit about how that piece is put together. It's a very fascinating organ piece, and one I learned when I was in college. The first one that I was able to choose that I wanted to learn before I actually learned it. So anyway, please email me if you would like. Make comments. We are constantly trying to refine our sound and our lighting and our photographing of these events. Let us know what you think. We'd appreciate that so much. God bless you today and always.